So I'm Susan Thornton Hobby, and I moved to Columbia. This is like Columbia Anonymous. Hi, I'm Susan Thornton Hobby, and I moved to Columbia when I was 7. Hi, Linda Joy. So I moved here when I was 7, which is a long time to live in one place. I did go away and lived other places, but came back. And when I was thinking about resistance, Stephen, and I was thinking about the different kinds of people that live in Columbia when I was thinking about this essay, because Jim Rouse had some things to say about getting to know your neighbor and loving your neighbor that were really important to me and to my parents, because that's why they moved here. I didn't really get a choice. So the essay starts off with some guy named Plato. So here it is. Until philosophers rule as kings, or those who are now called kings and leading men genuinely and adequately philosophize, that is, until political power and philosophy entirely coincide, while the many natures who at present pursue either one exclusively are forcibly prevented from doing so, cities will have no rest from evils, nor, I think, will the human race. Plato, he's a complicated guy. So when Jim Rouse, more philosopher than king, envisioned his planned city of Columbia, he never called it the perfect city. Instead, Columbia would be a rational city, he always said. 50 years, I can't believe it, 50 years after its first residents moved in, this city is still, as far as humanly possible, a rational place. But its foundation was love. In September 1963, Rouse delivered a paper at the University of California, Berkeley, at the conference on the metropolitan future. It sounds very dry, doesn't it? But Rouse, of course, shook up the conference by telling the gathered developers that they were asking the wrong questions. They were concentrating on roads and construction and logistics. Instead, they should be asking about people. Quote, this is from his speech. It should be our purpose to grow inspired, concerned, loving people, he told the audience. An inspired and concerned society will dignify man, will find ways to develop his talents, will put the fruits of his labor and intellect to effective use, will struggle for brotherhood and the elimination of bigotry and intolerance, will care for the indigent, the delinquent, the sick, the aged, will seek the truth and communicate it, will respect differences among men. And Rouse shocked the audience further by quoting the Bible, "Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." The foundation of this new city should be love, Rouse had decided. A year before he traveled to Berkeley for the conference, Rouse's subterfuge had already begun. Shell corporations were buying chunks of Howard County, all the farmland, eventually acquiring 14,000 acres of farmland. Because this place was nothing. I don't know if anybody remembers, but we remember driving. You remember, Kathy?
62.
You remember, we'd drive up 29 and there was nothing. There was nothing. There was the All View Inn, which is now a liquor store. There was the All View Inn, and that was it. We used to do Chinese fire drills on Route 29 and the stoplights. Oh my gosh, were we crazy? Those were some high school. So the foundation of this new city would be love. Small villages were better for getting to know neighbors. So Rouse planned 9 of them, River Hill King. With shops and worship and recreation and nature in each village. The city's innovative elements, the communal mailbox, love those, the village centers, the neighborhood pools, the interfaith centers, they were devised to channel people into each other's paths. The villages were planned so that it was, quote, easy and automatic and comfortable to see one another and know one another, share hopes and fears and ideas, and be able to deal with life together, Rouse said in a 1994 interview with me. And then Rouse had to sell the planned city idea, first to a mostly rural county and its commissioners, and then to the potential residents, you know, all the families that were going to have to come and live here. The Rouse Company representatives, including Rouse, went to 18 months of meetings, presenting their plans to PTAs, farm bureaus, political groups, and church congregations. And Rouse had a strategy for all those taking questions, some of which became hostile. You know, if you're a rural county and somebody wants to come in and plop a city in, sometimes they would get hostile. Quote, Jim said, "I made a rule then that anybody being asked a question should assume that the person asking it was a good friend who was misadvised. We would never regard them as an enemy." Sometimes I wish there was that kind of wisdom around. After all the presentations, Rouse posted the city's plans in a mansion on Route 29 where 10,000 people came to visit the exhibit. It's a lot of people in this tiny county. Then he proposed the plan before the county commissioners. Not a single person opposed the zoning. I can't imagine that nowadays. And neither did Rouse. Quote, "Astonishing for 45,000 people," Rouse said, referring to the population of the county at that point. "So it works. If you respect people, and if you also genuinely believe that what you are doing is right, not wrong, not abusive, not greedy, people are apt to be for it. Fundamentally, people want to do what's right." So Rouse was a true believer in doing what he thought was right. The Rouse Company had four goals, he explained from his corner office. It overlooked Lake Kittamakundi in the American Cities building. And he had this giant desk, which is now in the Columbia Archives. You can go and see it. It's a beautiful desk. He said, quote, "To build a real city, not a better suburb, with all the elements of a real city, to respect the land, to provide for the growth and life and growth of man, woman, and family, and the fourth was to make a profit." So many questioned his ability to profit, especially because Rouse planned this city to be integrated, both racially and socioeconomically. In the early 1960s, think about what was happening. Race riots, fair housing protests, white flight, anti-Vietnam activism. They were churning up the political and developmental soup. The country was divided, much of it is as it is now, economically and racially. The radical idea of a fully integrated city struck many as insane. Most American cities before Columbia grew by accretion. So they were segregated, if not legally, then by convention. There was a wrong side of the tracks, right? When I left Columbia, I moved to Catonsville, I went, what do you mean all the black people live in one place? That's crazy. I was very naive. So Columbia opened a year before Johnson opened the fair, or before Johnson signed the Fair Housing Act in 1968. As one of the first open housing communities in the nation. The Rouse Company filled an exhibit center on Lake Kittamakundi with maps and brochures, exhibits with light up maps and models, even a 3-screen slideshow, which I remember watching from the floor while all the grown-ups got all the cool stools. I had to sit on the floor. So there were 10 hostesses. 4 were African American, 6 were white. It was a racial proportion that Rouse made sure was maintained. They staffed the building. Quote, "This is Columbia, young and growing, a city you can be part of, a place where you can find your place, a new kind of city, a growing place for people." That's what the slideshow ended on. It's a big triumphant ending. And the Rouse Company was careful about photos in the slideshow. It showed a range of different kinds of people and families in the photos, not just the rich white people in the glossy brochures of most of America's new developments. Rouse didn't just have a goal of racial openness. He wanted his community to be integrated economically. Columbia's goal was 10% low to moderate incoming housing. And those developments were strategically placed in prime spots, like on water or on the hills, so they had good views, near the amenities. Quote, "Initially when we laid out every neighborhood, we laid it out deliberately so that it would produce vertical economic integration, or vertical economic circumstances," Rouse said. "The right mix of residents, would different incomes, different religions, different colors, would round out the town. That conglomeration of people would become the fertile soil for a real city," he hoped. Quote, "This was very deliberately in opposition to the popular myth that you can't mix people racially or socioeconomically," Rouse said. "People are really ready for so much more than we offer in the world. People live behind enclosures that really don't express what they want in all kinds of ways." Thank you very much.